Welcome. We are glad that you are here at Holly Naz. If you're online, thanks for being with us. Let's open with a word of prayer. Dear Heavenly Father, Lord, you know we come before you with grateful hearts, Lord, thanking you for all the blessings and everything that you do for us, Lord. Just we ask that you guide us and direct us through our thoughts and our words today. In Jesus' name.
You died and hung on.
be seated. She left out the drum roll.
Everybody, good to see all your smiling faces this lovely, warm, beautiful day. Good. It's good morning. Yeah, good morning, right? All right, perfect. Okay. I am shaking at the moment because I had to sing into the microphone. So, Community Unite, on Saturday, which is this Saturday, December 16th, we're having another senior lunch. And I'll be making my famous two soups. If I don't make my famous two soups, there's a couple ladies that show up that would get upset with me. Every time they show up, like, you making your bean and ham soup? Or you making your chicken noodle soup? I'm like, oh, I'm not cooking this time. Oh, man, that's a bummer. So if I tell them I'm cooking and I'm not making those soups, they will be upset. So I will be cooking at least my two famous soups. And I need some volunteers. There's a sign-up sheet. This almost happens organically at this point. People come in, people start serving. I pretty much handle the kitchen. Wednesday night, we will set up. Or Wednesday night, you guys will set up. Okay. Ed's like, okay. So I expect to come in Friday, everything set up, ready to go. And then and then we're packing the Christmas basket lunches. Mary needs to speak into the microphone so everybody can hear her. Speak right into it.
Hello? All right, I talked to Rachel, who is handling the Christmas boxes. There is a list of things that they still need. It looks to me like we have 27 boxes going out. So anybody that would like to sign up, I need to know today because they're going to purchase the stuff that they need before it's all gone out of the stores because she's already running into that. So if you could just afterwards sign up for what you want, and I just need it here next Sunday. So, and I'll take it over to her and they'll box it up and pass them out.
Thank you, Mary.
Yeah, so I know Mary started working with Colin, Rachel, and working at the Thursday night food pantry with Rachel, and she found out that her and Rachel are neighbors, like across the street, like literally, like across the street. You can see Rachel's house from. It's interesting how the world just continues to get smaller and smaller. And then on the 17th, which is next Sunday at 2 p.m., there's a Christmas tea. Let's consider that women's Christmas tea. So if you want to go to the Christmas tea and you're a man, we can have our own Christmas tea, but this is for the women. And they'll have fun. And that's at 2 p.m. next Sunday. What's that? Bring a $15 gift if you're coming. Okay. Yeah, that's here. Yep. So if you have any questions, talk to Diane or Mary or Sheila. Apparently, they know all the details as far as what's going on for the Christmas tea. I just know it's at 2 p.m., and I'm not supposed to be here. Now, those that are here, most of those are here, probably get my text. I know Dwayne's on the list, and I got a whole bunch of people on the list. And if you want to be on the list of the texts I send out, I will send out probably at the most 2 texts a week. It'll come through as a 94,000 number. It'll say Holly Naz right at the top. And, you know, it like I said, I don't know if it was last week or a couple weeks ago, that text, it's a mass text that goes out to every individual. So when you respond back, you respond back directly to me. Right? That's the key. It's not a mass text that if you respond back, 50 other people see it. What's that? It's not a group text. Yeah, it's definitely not a group text. It's a mass text, the first one. But then after that, if we start a conversation, it's just you and I having a conversation. So you can feel free to respond to me. That's just directly to me. But who is reading the joy of every longing heart? They've asked a couple questions yesterday that I thought were interesting. Everyone read yesterday, right? Everyone that was reading did yesterday's devotion, that are reading it, that have the book. Okay. So I know, it does feel like you're in high school. You're getting ready for a quiz. The question he asked, number one, is what makes you feel spiritually inferior to others? What makes you feel spiritually inferior to others? Their knowledge of the Bible versus yours, okay, or maybe how often they pray. And those of us that, you know, read 7 minutes a day, we're not like some other people like Ed who reads 70 minutes a day. You know, things like that. I'm just joking, Ed. But things like that, Ed's like, I do read 70 minutes a day. I'm retired. I have nothing else to do. Oh. The bottom line is we're not supposed to feel spiritually inferior to anybody. In God's eyes, we're all the same. Understand that. In God's eyes, we're all the same. Question number two, in your imagination, do you worry about placement among the saints? Do you actually worry about this? I hope not, right? I hope you're, you know, I'm a gold medal saint. But the truth is we're all gold medal saints in the eyes of God, right? Every single one of us is up there with a gold medal. There's no such thing as a gold, silver, and bronze. We're all gold medal saints in God's eyes. As long as we believe in him and believe that he's the Son of God and he died for our sins, we're all gold medal saints. Do you understand that? You get that, right? We laugh, and yeah, it's kind of funny, but that's who we are in the eyes of God, right? I'm not a bronze medal or just barely, oh, you're competing, you know. No, we are all gold medal saints in the eyes of God. And how can you assure your sense of belonging within the church? You participate. Just participate within the church. Be a part of the church. Be a part of the church body somehow, some way. Participate in one way, shape, or form or another. It's simple, right? Ask questions, gets you in trouble. And one way that we can belong to the church is we pray for one another. What are we praying for one another? Ephesians 3, 14 through 21. Ephesians 3, 14 through 21. So throughout the week, you know, not necessarily every day, and I specifically pick 2 days where I read Ephesians 3, 14 through 21, and I pray for somebody. I pick on somebody within the church. It's not even necessarily the church walls here. Understand that, within the church, the big C church of other believers that I personally have contact with. Right? I'm not praying for somebody that's within the church that I just happen to know of. I have a relationship with the person I'm praying for within the church. And I'm letting them know I'm praying Ephesians 3:14-21 for them. I'm just going to read 18 and 19 at this point. And may you have the power to understand, as all God's people should, how wide, how long, how high, and how deep his love is. May you experience the love of Christ, though it's too great to fully understand. Then you will be made complete with all the fullness of life and the power that comes from God. May you have the power to understand. Think about that. May you have the power to understand. May you experience the love of Christ. May you experience the love of Christ. When you have the power to understand, you experience the love of Christ, then you're made complete with all the fullness of life and power that comes from God. Christ came so we could be miserable. No, Christ came so we could have a full, abundant life, so that love overflowing is tangible within us. So that every day you wake up, you have the ability to love more by the end of the day than the previous day. And if you don't think that's a possibility, start praying about it. Pray for yourself and pray for others that your love will increase. That your love will increase. And as your love increases, you understand God's love more, you start to really truly love others more. So who wants prayer today? Right here. Yes, you want prayer today. We are picking on you. We're going to pray for you. We're going to pray for you mostly. And we'll pray for your daughter, but mostly for you. Father, we thank you for your love, for your grace, and your mercy. And Lord, we place Tina before you. Lord, as we lift her up to you, Father, I ask that she will fully understand the love of Christ. Lord, that you will open her mind, open her heart, open her understanding, and let her know more of it, of how wide and how long and how deep and how high your love is. Lord, that she will have the power to understand that. Father, I just ask, Holy Spirit, that you will flood her with so much love that it will ooze out of her pores. It'll ooze out of her pores. Father, touch her in a way that she knows that she is precious in your sight, that she is a masterpiece created by you. Give her love overflowing, joy indescribable, and peace beyond measure. Lord, as we lift Tina up to you, I want to lift your daughter up to you. Your daughter, right? Yes. I lift your daughter up to you, Lord, and I want to pray for her too, Lord, and place her before you. And Lord, you know all things. Lord, I don't know what's going on. Don't need to. I just am praying for her. Lord, lifting her up to you. Lifting Tina up to you as well. That the peace of God that transcends all understanding will guard her heart and her mind, Lord, that you will just flow into her. Give her a triple portion of the Holy Spirit today. In your name we pray, amen.
Amen. Amen. Thank you.
You're welcome. So as we did last week, I'm going to read, and everyone's going to respond to what comes up on the screen. The steadfast love of God was present in the distant past, and we remember. We remember God's covenant with Abraham and with Abraham's descendants. We remember God's steadfast, remember God's faithfulness to all who came after. The steadfast love of God was present in our past, and we remember. We remember the faithfulness of the people who started this church, who taught Sunday school, preached sermons, and loved well. We remember those in our family and in our communities who taught us and loved us with patience and with grace. The steadfast love of God is present now, and we remember. As we light the second candle, we ask the God of steadfast love to help us remember where God was faithful in the past and trust that God will be faithful again. As we remember God's ultimate expression of love through Christ's birth, life, death, and resurrection, may we trust that God still loves us with a faithful and everlasting love. I was forgetting something. Like, there's something I need to do here. Father, we thank you for your love, for your grace, and your mercy. And Lord, as we take a few moments to give back to you, Holy Spirit, help us to be joyful givers. Help us to remember all that you've done for us, all that you've blessed us for, the things that we can't even begin to comprehend. Lord, just let us be thankful. Let us understand that you love us so much. And as we give just a little bit back to you, once again, Lord, just take our offerings and multiply them. And do more than we can even begin to think and imagine. In your name we pray, amen. I remember my Sunday school lessons in the Lutheran church just a couple years ago because I'm just a really young guy. Hey, it's the faithfulness of those folks who came before us, who passed on God's love to us, that we're all here. Right? If it wasn't for their faithfulness, we wouldn't be here. The church wouldn't exist. So today, open up your Bibles to Psalm 85. Psalm 85. So as you work your way to Psalm 85, we're going to talk about God's steadfast love. The Hebrew word for God's steadfast love is hesed. Get a Hebrew lesson today. Hesed. It's interesting that the writer of the book, because I'm using his sermon outline, that he said is steadfast love in verse 7. Well, if you look at the New Living Translation that we're about to read, you're going to see it's God's unfailing love. And I had to look through multiple versions before I finally found that it was translated steadfast love. But ultimately, the idea is that he said is a type of love that where we come to expect something from someone. Daniel Boone defines he said as the behavior of one person has the right to expect the behavior that one person has the right to expect of another in light of promises that were made. Who here has ever been married? And when you're standing there, when you're getting married and you're pouring out your love and how much you're going to love the person, there's an expectation that the person's going to love you back. Right? There is. There's a covenant that's made, and he said. Steadfast love, there's an expectation that that person's going to love me back. So we understand marriage, we understand covenants. When you stand there, you make a marriage covenant, it's something, an agreement between two people. I'm going to love you, you're going to love me. I'm going to love you in sickness and in health until I get sick of you. And then love you some more, right? That's the key, and love you some more, right? But God's covenant is so far beyond ours. God's steadfast love, never ending, never changing, unfailing. We can expect God to love us only when we do the right things. When can we expect God to love us? All the time. Regardless of what we do, regardless of what we say, God loves us all the time with a steadfast, unfailing love. Let's read Psalm 85. Lord, you poured out blessings on your land. You restored the fortunes of Israel. You forgave the guilt of your people. Yes, you covered all their sins. You held back your fury. You kept back your blazing anger. Now restore us again, O God of our salvation. Put aside your anger against us once more. Will you be angry with us always? Will you prolong your wrath to all generations? Won't you revive us again so that your people can rejoice in you? Show us your unfailing love, O Lord, and grant us your salvation. I listen carefully to what God the Lord is saying, for he speaks peace to all his faithful people. But let them not return to their foolish ways. Surely his salvation is near those who fear him, so our land will be filled with his glory. Unfailing love and truth have met together. Righteousness and peace have kissed. Truth springs up from the earth, and righteousness smiles down from heaven. Yes, the Lord pours down his blessings. Our land will yield its bountiful harvest. Righteousness goes as a herald before him, preparing the way for his steps. So, in verses 1 through 3, they're talking about God's faithfulness in the past. When did God's faithfulness to Israel start? What's that? The very beginning, but specifically to Israel. When did God's faithfulness to Israel start? With Abraham. With Abraham. God made a covenant with Abraham. Absolutely. And in Genesis 15, I'm going to flip to Genesis 15. God makes a covenant with Abraham. We'll start at verse 1. Sometime later, the Lord spoke to Abram in a vision and said to him, "Do not be afraid, Abram, for I will protect you, and your reward will be great." But Abram replied, "O sovereign Lord, what good are all your blessings when I don't have a son? Since you've given me no children, Eleazar of Damascus, a servant of my household, will inherit all my wealth. You've given me no descendants of my own, so one of my servants will be my heir." And the Lord said to him, "No, your servant will not be your heir, for you will have a son of your own who will be your heir." And the Lord took Abram outside and said to him, "Look up into the sky and count the stars if you can. That's how many descendants you will have." Here's Abram, strapping young lad of 80-ish at this point, has no children, and God's going to come and say, hey, you're going to have children, so many, so will you be your descendants. You can't even count them all. Mm-hmm. Sure, God, I believe you. Then Abram believed the Lord. Okay, he's an old man. He hasn't had children yet. But he believed the Lord, and the Lord counted him as righteous because of his faith. And the Lord told him, I am the Lord who brought you out of Ur of the Chaldeans to give you the land as your possession. But Abram replied, O sovereign Lord, how can I be sure that I will actually possess it? The Lord told him, bring me a three-year-old heifer and a three-year-old female goat, a three-year-old ram, a turtle dove, and a young pigeon. So Abram presented all these to him, killed them, then cut each animal down the middle, laid the halves side by side. He did not, however, cut the birds in half. So vultures swooped down to eat the carcass, but Abram chased them away. Visualize this. This is gross. I'm going to take a heifer, cut it right down the middle, and the goat, cut it right down the middle, put one half here, one half here. That's a mess. Yeah, a lot of blood, a lot of guts, a lot of gore, just gross. Now, you've got to understand, we're talking about a different culture completely. This is a covenant that two people would normally make way back when Abram was walking the earth. And the two parties of the covenant would walk through this gore, representing that if you don't uphold your side of the covenant, you're going to end up like these animals. It's a pretty serious covenant, though, isn't it? Yeah, and yeah, it's just not pretty. But as the sun went down, Abram fell into deep sleep, and terrifying darkness came down over him. The Lord said to Abram, you can be sure that your descendants will be strangers in a foreign land where they'll be oppressed and slaves for 400 years. But I will punish the nation that enslaves them, and in the end, they will come away with great wealth. As for you, you will die in peace and be buried at a ripe old age. After four generations, your descendants will return here to this land, for the sin of the Amorites do not yet warrant their destruction. After the sun went down, the darkness fell. Abram saw a smoking pot and a flaming torch pass between the halves of the carcass. So the Lord made a covenant with Abram that day and said, I have given your land to all your descendants all the way from the border of Egypt to the great Euphrates River. Is the Lord faithful to his covenant? Who are the descendants of Abraham? Who else is the descendants of Abraham? The Israelites. Jews. Do they possess that land at the moment? They're working to possess. They don't possess all of it, you're right, but it's a thing. Think about this for a second, though. They don't possess all of it. What was it, 1947, they became official nation again? 48? I wasn't alive in 48. But if you're thinking about God's covenant and saying, okay, the nation of Israel is going to possess this land, and now the Lord gave them back the land. I mean, granted, they don't have all of it, but God's faithfulness lasts for a few years. Yeah, forever, right? Through generation after generation after generation after generation. How many Jews are there out there? A lot. And that's the thing. We can't count them all, right? We're not even aware of all of it at this point. There's so many people and descendants. Way back when, I want to make a covenant with an old man who hasn't had any children yet. God is faithful. God says he's going to do something. We can expect that God will do it because of covenants done in the past. Now go back to Psalm 85. And the writer of Psalm 85, they're taking a look at what God has done in the past. Verses 1 through 3. Lord, you poured out your blessings on the land. You restored the fortunes of Israel. You forgave the guilt of your people. Yes, you covered all their sins. You held back your fury. You kept back your blazing anger. How many times did the nation of Israel mess up? Quite a bit, right? Sort of like us, a lot like us, right? And that's the beauty of it right there is when we start to compare the nation of Israel to us. But they are remembering God's faithfulness and what God has done. God, you made this covenant that we would possess this land. You made this covenant that we would be your people. They're looking at the past because they're currently in exile. They're currently in exile at this point. They're not in Israel. So God, I'm going to look at what you did in the past. I'm going to remember your faithfulness. I'm going to remember your steadfast love, God. And then in verses 4 and 6, they're going to plead. They're going to plead to God. Now restore us again. Restore us again, O God of our salvation. Put aside your anger against us once more. Will you be with us? Will you be angry? Will you be angry with us? Always. Will you prolong your wrath to all generations? Won't you revive us again so your people can rejoice in you? Who here is like messed up so often that they don't think God can be, God, where are you? God, I'm. Nation of Israel did it over and over and over again. God, in the past you were faithful. God, we know we're sinning at the moment. We know we're not where we're supposed to be. But there's a change. There's a repentance. There's a calling out now. Okay, yeah, I know what I did. But God, please, are you going to be angry with me forever? Show us your unfailing love, O Lord, and grant us your salvation. Show us your unfailing love and grant us your salvation. Verses 8 and 9. I listen carefully to what the Lord God is saying, and he speaks peace to all his faithful people. But let them not return to their foolish ways. Surely his salvation is near to those who fear him. So our land will be filled with his glory. God's faithful in his promises. Always faithful in his promises. God, we know that you're angry with us. We know that we are exiled because you're angry with us. But restore us again. Let us be faithful. Let us be faithful to you. Those are repentance, a repentance of turning from their ways. Let us be faithful to you, Lord. Not, Lord, restore us again while we continue to not love you. Restore us, Lord. Give us all the blessings of God while we go live in debauchery and worship the piece of wood. No. Let us be faithful. Let us return back to you. And as we return to you, you restore us again. Your steadfast, unfailing love. Verses 10 through 13 connect these themes. Unfailing love and truth have met together. Faithfulness and love are connected. This is a covenant language again. When we truly love with the love of God, when we truly love with the love of God, we're faithful. Catch that? When we truly love with the love of God, we are faithful. Righteousness of peace, kiss. There's a deep connection between righteousness, doing the right things for the right reasons, and peace. When we seek righteousness, peace comes with it. Why am I righteous? Because of Jesus, right? My salvation, Jesus himself makes me righteous. Because he makes me righteous, I want to do the right things. Do I always do the right things? No, but I want to. There's a desire within me to always do the right things. And I know that my righteousness is filthy rags to God. But I know that I am righteous. My righteous deeds are filthy rags, right? If I'm trying to be righteous on my own, am I going to get there? No. I am righteous because of Christ. When I finally firmly root myself that my righteousness is in Christ and Christ alone, my peace grows. My peace grows. Faithfulness and righteousness are viewed as abundance from God. Faithfulness and righteousness are viewed as abundance from God. Yes, the Lord pours down his blessings. Our land will yield its bountiful harvest. Righteousness goes as a herald before him, preparing the way of his steps. Who here has been blessed by God? Who here has been blessed by God so many times that you can't even count them anymore? Yeah, for sure. And God will bless us even more when we're faithful to him. We put him number one. Absolutely. Absolutely. It's when we think about this psalm, we think about, you know, God, you were faithful in the past. Please restore me again. We should remember the steadfast love and faithfulness of God in the past. And we can do that multiple ways. When we remember God's steadfast love and his faithfulness of the past, there's multiple ways to do this. What's one way? Yeah, this right here, right? As you read your 7 minutes a day, you see that God's faithfulness in the past to the believers. Sometimes to the believers, sometimes to Israel, right? God, restore us. Does God eventually restore Israel? Yeah. God is faithful. God will do what he says. And think about the stories of church history. Think about guys like Calvin, Martin Luther, John Wesley. We can keep naming people. Big, all the apostles, right? But I'm thinking more of the Dark Ages, when Scripture was squashed, when where was the church? Where was that remnant of believers? It was there. And we have spiritual awakenings. We have revivals. We can remember those revivals, right? Different points in history, different people. And there's, you can name how many spiritual, let's call them spiritual giants, if you will. The super gold medalists. But we remember church history. We can look at different points where God has just moved. Think about the stories of your family, your friends. Who here has a story they've told somebody about God's faithfulness? Yeah. I look at different people, and I know some people's stories, and their stories encourage me because I can see how God was faithful to them. So remember your story. How was God faithful to you? Was God ever faithful to you? Yeah. Over and over and over again, right? So we remember God's faithfulness, remember his steadfast love, and we can do it in many ways. We should lament the broken covenants we see around us. We should lament those. And the reason we should lament those is because when we maybe not do it on purpose, but when we think of God, we tend to put traits upon God. So we tend to put traits upon God of people we know and people we see. That makes sense? So a loving father. God is a loving father. God's a good father. And you get someone that has not had a loving father. And you try to explain to them that God is the loving father. How could God be the loving father? My father wasn't loving. You may not do it on purpose, but to a certain point, it's not just that particular analogy. if you know couples that gotten married, you're like, oh man, they're going to make it. They have this covenant love. They're so strong and they get divorced. Covenants are broken all the time. Well, people break covenants. Why would God be faithful? Not that we do it on purpose, but it's tough. You know, I thank God every day that I had a fantastic father. I can relate to God as a loving father. So we should and ought to lament that when people have been abused or neglected by their parents, how do we show them that God truly is a loving father and that God is not like your natural parents? That becomes an extremely tough hurdle sometimes to overcome, a healing that needs to take place. As we show people the steadfast love of God, that God is different, that God is faithful, that God loves us once in a while. All the time. I just want to make sure you're listening. We're in the season of Advent. And it's a good time to reflect on what causes us to feel unworthy and unloved. And at some point, I'm going to venture to say it, at some point, almost everyone, there might be one person or two people in the building, that at some point has felt unworthy and unloved. Sometimes it's stronger than others. That's part of the human condition. When we feel unworthy, when we feel unloved, who loves us? Who loves us always? Who loves us with a steadfast, unfailing love? Are you fully convinced of that? 100% of the time? I hope so. If you're not convinced of that, where do you go? You nailed it, though. It's not just me, but it's another believer. Yeah, another believer, right? Have you opened up the Word of God and had it feel dry to you? Have you opened up the Word of God and had it feel dry? It just doesn't speak. Yeah, it doesn't speak. Yeah, right. So in those moments when the Word of God is dry, when the Word of God isn't speaking to me, that's why we're a part of a church. That's why we're with other believers. Maybe God at that point is like, you know, I want you to go talk to Ed. I want you to go have that spiritual conversation. I want him to uplift you. I want him to encourage you. I want him to speak life into you. That's why the church exists. We're supposed to be together. Whether it's here on Sunday morning, Wednesday night, Tuesday night, at some point we should be with believers, right? Because God designed it that way. So when I'm going through a time, when I'm feeling unworthy, when I'm feeling unloved, and the Word of God just doesn't do it for me. Sometimes prayer just doesn't do it for me. I found so much encouragement in believers. When I'm feeling unworthy, when I'm feeling unloved, when I'm feeling like I can't do this anymore, I find so much encouragement when I talk to someone like me, and they have the same feelings I do. Like, whew, that means this is okay. This is okay to feel this way. I'm not unique. I'm not different. We all struggle in the same ways. For me, when I find someone struggles like I do, I get so much encouragement out of it. So I know it's part of the human condition. And together, we look back to the steadfast love of God. And we see that his love truly is unfailing. That he will love us no matter what I do, no matter what I say, even no matter what I think. His love is completely, utterly unfailing. If you're feeling unworthy, you're feeling unloved, look to somebody that you respect. You can come talk to me, we can pray together, or we just talk. There's others in the church that I'm sure you look up to. Go to that person. Talk to them. Tell them exactly where you're at, what's going through your head. Because at no point, at least for me for sure, at no point am I going to call you foolish for having these thoughts. Call you foolish for feeling this way. I'm going to encourage you. I'm going to walk with you. And hopefully strengthen you. Hopefully, once again, get you back to the point where you have love overflowing, joy indescribable, and peace beyond measure. Because God loves us unconditionally, all the time, every minute of every second, of every millisecond, of every day. Regardless of what you do, what you say, or what you think. Father, we love you. We do, and we thank you that your faithfulness, your steadfast love is totally beyond our understanding. That it is unconditional and it is always constant. Holy Spirit, as we go throughout this week, help us to remember the love of Christ. As we go throughout this season of Advent, that we remember that you came to earth, Emmanuel, God with us, because of your love, of your great, unfailing, steadfast love for us. And Lord, then help us to take your steadfast love, your unfailing love, and to give that to others. Fill us with so much love that it oozes out of our pores and into those around us. Help us to be the light that shines forth in the darkness, that brings people the love of God. Father, we thank you for sending your Son. Jesus, we thank you for giving up your Godhead to be amongst us, to be one of us, to fully know us completely. We thank you that you've given us a way to the Father. And Holy Spirit, we thank you that you reside within us, that you guide us, that you teach us. And I ask that you fill us again. And restore us. And revive us. In your name we pray. Amen. Those online, have a fantastic week.